Before we get going today, I'd like to know, are there any economists in the audience? Any economists? A couple of you? Sir? Any other? I know there are other economists standing there doing, or sitting there doing a cost-benefit analysis. If I put my hand up, I might get my question answered. Then again, I might get ridiculed. Anybody having done the cost-benefit analysis like to raise their hand? Okay, so we've got two economists here with us today. Did you gentlemen bring earphones or earplugs or anything like that? No? No? Okay. You might want to put them in, that's all. Right. Now, don't get me wrong. Some of my best friends are economists. But I'm not. These days, I've got a $10 title. I didn't put it on there. But I'm the Chief Market Strategist. I reckon that's worth a bit of a head wobble, right? But by choice and by experience, by long experience, I'm really a trader. Right? That's what I do. And I'm lucky enough to do it professionally. I have done for many, many years now. At CMC, we have a podcast series, which I host. It's called The Artful Trader. And it's just an example of one of the great opportunities I get being a professional trader. I get to interview some of the greatest names and minds in the investment and markets world. I've interviewed Jack Swagger. He's the editor, he's the author of the Market Wizard series. And if you want to learn more about what professional investors and traders do, I heavily recommend the Market Wizard series to you. But I got to interview Linda Bradford Raske, who some of you may know. She's a very good trader herself, but also a trading coach. I got to interview John Netto, the protean trader, also another professional trader who shared his insights on markets with our audience. And I got to interview Annie Duke, who won a World Series of Poker bracelet. She won the tournament and is also a cognitive psychologist. And she had some really interesting things to say about decision making under pressure. All of that's very useful, but the person I'm thinking of at the moment is a trader who goes by the name of Rao Powell. Rao traded with some of the world's largest investment banks. He's now situated in the Caymans, trading his own money only out of the Cayman Islands, and doing very nicely for himself. But he described working in the markets, and particularly as a trader, but also as an investor, as solving the most beautiful puzzle in the world. And that's the way I see the markets too. And whether we're investors or traders, we're doing essentially the same thing. We're trying to solve the market puzzle. Now, economics is a part of that. But it's only one part. It's important to know what part of our economic understanding of the world is influencing markets, but it's not the only answer. And today, I'd like to have a look at the nature of markets and why, at certain times, some numbers are important and why, at other times, they're not. So that's what we'll look at today, the numbers that count. If you ever go to a presentation on investment, on markets, on any kind of product, and you don't see a slide like this, run like crazy. Anybody who doesn't discuss the risks as well as the potential opportunities of markets is likely to do you a disservice, in my opinion. So it's important you see information like this. As investors, we all come to the market with different attributes. We have different time frames. We have different risk appetites. We have different levels of experience and understanding of the markets. And we have different needs, different goals, and different amounts of capital available to us. And the right answer to any investment question depends as much on your individual circumstances as it does on what's happening out in the market. In other words, the right choice is only the right choice for you because of your individual circumstances. And today, I'll be looking at the markets in general, but whether or not any of this information is useful to you is a decision entirely for you. I don't know your situation. This is general information. And the ultimate decision in the market, in your investment choices, and about what and who to listen to and rely on, is down to you. So please bear that in mind. There's some important information about the company I work for there, CMC Markets Stockbroking. And please bear in mind, everything today is hypothetical. Another way of saying that is the past is not necessarily a good guide to the future. I think you all know that one of the challenges we all face in the markets is that none of us know the futures. None of us know the future. We do know the futures markets. We don't know the future. And so all we can do is make the best decisions we can in light of our own circumstances and the market information available to us. And so let's start thinking about that market information. I've been involved in financial markets since 1983. I know, looking around the room, many people here have also been watching markets for at least that long. One of the things that strikes me is the fashion in market data. In the 80s, the biggest economic release was the monthly release of the balance of payments. Our external current account, in those days, deficit. It was key because the currency had just been floated in 1984, and the big driver of currencies is generally trade. And that constant deficit in our balance of payments each month meant that the Aussie dollar was under pressure. And so every month, everybody in the market, whichever market they're in, turned and listened in to the balance of payments. I doubt if there's two people in this room who can tell me what the current balance of payments is. And that's okay. It's because in that time, what was in fashion as far as the market was concerned was the balance of payments. It's what they chose to focus on. And that's important because we use numbers to describe markets, and that can fool us. That can fool us into thinking that markets are somehow scientific or mathematic or even logical. And as I say, I'm not down on all economists. The reason I don't use economics much was one of the first things I was told is that consumers are rational beings who act to maximise their utility. Well, that's obvious rubbish. Look around you. Look at the way people shop. Look at the way they invest. We know that's not true. And that's why I disregard it. I'm a modeller of financial products, markets, whatever. And I know if you put garbage into a model, you'll get garbage out. And I could see garbage in classical economics. Now, luckily, things have improved. And the world of behavioural finance and economics is recognising the real way that people operate in the real world. It's giving us more clues. But for that reason, I didn't have much time for economics. But I do, by way of assurance, have a favourite economist. It's John Maynard Keynes. And many of you would be familiar with Keynesian economics. It's not his economics that I like him for. What I like about Keynes is that he actually put his methods into practice. He tried to trade the markets, share markets, based on his economic understanding of the world. I admire that. He had the courage to try and put it into practice. That's what I do. My degree's in applied finance. Keynes went broke twice, bankrupt twice. Another reason to be leery of economics. But he did say something very important. He said that markets can remain irrational a lot longer than you or I can remain solvent. And I absolutely agree with that. And one of the things I have to accept as a trader is the market is always right. But it made me wonder about the nature of markets and the nature of prices. And I would argue, just as Keynes did, that markets are not mathematical. They are not scientific, and there are long periods when they're a long way from logical. Instead, markets are organic. Prices are simply a matter of opinion. They're very sincere opinions. People are putting their money behind their opinions, but they're opinions. And a price is a product of crowd behaviour. People who buy up until this level, people who will sell down to that level, and we find the equilibrium. So prices themselves are the product of an organic process, not a mathematical process, not a logical process, but they are the product of crowd behaviour. So what other people think is very important to where the markets will go. They're organic in nature. It's why they can be illogical. It's why they're not mathematical or scientific. And it's why they're subject to fashion. Now, That's not to say that the market system is not complex. It's very complex. This machine is very simple in comparison to the dynamics that drive the global markets and our local share market. This machine is very simple, but you can see there are a lot of moving parts. Now, some people just like engines, and I'd argue that's what economists are like. They like the whole engine and they want to know all about it. But if you're the driver of this car, you want to know about the crucial bits that are making the difference, and whether or not that's the air that's being mixed with the fuel that comes into your engine, or whether or not it's the spark that's coming into the cylinders. You need to know which parts of the engine are the most important. And as an investor and a trader, that's what I need to know too. So markets are organic in nature, in my opinion. You're welcome to keep your own. And they are complex. And understanding which parts to focus on is one of the keys to long-term investment success. So today, I'm going to have a look at the current state of play for the Australian share market and give you two lines in the sand for the market. Because if markets truly are organic, the price in itself is a clue as to what the market's doing. And we'll have a look at that in a moment. We'll then look at what I think are the three key factors for markets globally and locally, and some of the indicators that we can watch to get an idea of how those factors are evolving. And then I'll put some numbers on the line for you. As I say, once again, whether or not this information is useful is a decision entirely for you. But these are the numbers that I'm watching. These are the ones that I think will make the biggest difference to where the market goes in the future. So let's start with a look at current market. And I always like to take the big picture. And this is the big picture. This is the Australian share market, the ASX 200 index. And this is a monthly chart. Each one of those blue and pink candles represents 1 month's trading. So we really are having a look at the big picture here. Now, this chart covers all of this century's trading. It starts in 1999. So you can see right here the huge bull run that we had from late 2003 up to November 17th, 2007. The market went from below 3,000 points to 6,852. That's an extraordinary gain in less than 4 years. The market more than doubled. It's worth thinking about. We often think in terms of the next few hundred points in either direction, but particularly for people who have long investment timeframes, years, decades even, it's worth remembering what the market can do over time. It's not going to act that way all the time, of course, but it is worth remembering. So here's the crash, of course, the GFC, the one we're all still bearing scars from. And the rebuild that we've seen since that low in March 2009. And you can see that although there've been plenty of pullbacks along the way, even most recently, overall the direction here is upward. And one of the things to take away from this is the gains we've seen in the Australian share market are much more sustainable because they've been made much more carefully. This is just a rip and tear. That is a roaring bull market. And roaring bull markets usually end in disruptive bear markets. But markets that build over time, generally speaking, and have regular refreshes, pullbacks, corrections on the way, are generally making much more sustainable gains. And the caution that we all learnt out of the GFC around equities is reflected in that. But here are the two lines. 5640 has dominated previous reaction. And in October, just a couple of weeks ago, we touched that level again, 5640. Now, the idea behind technical analysis, the simple idea behind it, is that if markets are organic and prices are the product of organic behaviour, of crowd behaviour, where the crowd made decisions in the past, they're likely to make decisions again. It's pretty straightforward. It's about human behaviour. So if the market gets to 5640 again, well, it did just 2 weeks ago, people will make decisions. It doesn't mean that they'll make the same decision they did last time. But it does mean they'll make decisions. And in this case, they decided that once again, 5640 was a good level to buy. So that has two key implications in strategy terms. First of all, it could be a good level to buy. And secondly, if it breaks, If the price goes below that level, it's a sign that things are getting worse. So that's one of the numbers I'm watching very closely, 5640. If the index trades below that level, it's a sign that we're likely to see, there are no guarantees in markets, but we're likely to see further falls. And the same with the top side. That level at 6,375 is the post-GFC high. And you can see there's only really one point on it that's post-GFC. We do have a level there at 6,000 as an interim measure. A breakthrough 6,000 or 5950 to 6,000 would be a sign the market's going to test that 6375. But if it breaks through that 6375, that's an indication that the market is likely to test the all-time high. So that's my upside line in the sand for the Australian index. So if either of those levels are breached, because the price is a product of what all of us are thinking and doing in the market, that will be a sign to me that we as a crowd have changed our minds and something new is coming. So they're my two lines in the sand. I would acknowledge that in technical analysis, there is certainly some science, but there's also a bit of art to technical analysis. And some people will disagree with my reading of it, and that's perfectly fine. We're talking about the future, so there's plenty of room for honest disagreement when it comes to discussing markets. But they're my two lines in the sand for the Australian market. Let's get on to the key factors. And this one's just become much more important. The reason, as you know, one of the key factors in the market falls that we've seen, I seem to be fading in and out a bit, don't I? Sorry. One of the key factors we've seen in the market falls over the last couple of months has been the trade disputes, most notably between the US and China, but also the US having a bit of a slash at the rest of the world, including Mexico, Canada, the EU. Australia's been exempted, but most other nations are in some way dragged in. Now let's get a couple of things on the table. First of all, a trade dispute, while it is potentially a drag on the global economy, is not a threat to the existence of the markets. Okay? It's very unlikely, can never say never, but it's very unlikely that a trade dispute would result in a major market correction. That is something like the GFC, the halving, or worse, of markets that we've seen. Very unlikely. Trade disputes simply aren't that big a part of the picture. They're important for growth, and growth prospects are important. We'll talk more about that in a little while. But trade disputes themselves are not a threat to the existence of markets. We still have to keep our eye on them, because slowing growth means slowing earnings. And if you don't know that already, earnings revision is the surest predictor we have of share market moves. When earnings are being revised upward for a single stock or for the broader market, the market is more likely to go up than not. And the reverse is true. If earnings are being revised downward at the individual stock level or for the general market, the market or that stock is much more likely to fall. Statistically, that is the surest predictor we have of share market moves. So bear that in mind. So if trade disputes result in people revising down their estimates, that's bad news for stocks. And it is likely to bring falls into the market, just as we've seen. Now, with the midterm elections out of the way and the Republicans losing control of the lower house in the US, there are some analysts who think that the White House might go to those areas of policy where it can act without the approval of Congress. And the most prominent of those is trade. The US president has a lot of power to decide trade policy on their own. And so there are concerns in markets, and we saw that reflected in the trading since the midterm elections. Although we saw some real enthusiasm for shares initially, that was moderated and there was a lot less enthusiasm in our area. Those of you who are watching might have noticed Hong Kong fell 2% yesterday. There are concerns that these trade wars will heat up. Now, there are a lot of numbers we could possibly look at for trade wars. I'd suggest reading the headlines rather than watching the numbers is your best bet here, because the response is going to be driven by market sentiment, not by any particular group of numbers. I was fooled yesterday. I came in and thought, gee, I know the markets in China and Hong Kong are very concerned about what happened after the election and what could happen. Let me just check on Canada and Mexico. And I pulled up the Mexican index and it was down 5%. I thought, wow, we are really worried about trade. No. What had happened was the regulator there had proposed a new banking tax, and the Mexican investors had naturally sold down banking shares, had nothing to do with it. So while Mexico, the Mexican peso versus the US dollar, Canadian dollar versus the US dollar, the Chinese yuan versus US dollar can all be good indicators of sentiment, there are other factors at play and we should be careful about them. So I'd suggest when it comes to this key factor for markets, trade, stick to the headlines. Unlike inflation and interest rates. Anyone familiar with this structure here? It's known as amoeba strip, amoeba strip. It's got various spellings. Mobius, yes, certainly. I found four different spellings. There must be at least four different pronunciations. It's an interesting piece from a mathematical point of view, and you can make one yourself if you take a strip of paper, put one twist in it, and glue the ends together. What that means is this has only one surface. Those runners will keep running forever, and they'll touch every part of that surface above and below. It has only one edge. If you trace along that edge, you will touch every part of it. It has only one edge. So from a mathematical point of view, it's quite interesting. But the analogy I'd like to make today is that this is about the relationship between inflation and interest rates. At the heart of every central bank's mandate is price stability, or sometimes they overtly say inflation. So inflation drives central bank behaviour, and interest rates drive markets. They drive currencies, they drive shares. So the interplay between inflation and interest rates is a key. The problem is, it's a good news, bad news scenario. We've had the most extraordinary injection of funds into the global economy we've ever seen. It's now being withdrawn. We've had the lowest interest rates we've ever seen. They're now being lifted. And the effects of that are unpredictable. But the reason things are, money's being withdrawn and rates are rising is the economy is improving. All right, so this is a two-edged sword. Good news, the economy's improving. Bad news, interest rates are going up, knocking your share portfolio down. How do we react? Well, the reality is the market's going to swing between those two poles, rewarding the better growth prospects and buying shares, and getting worried about interest rates rising, the hit that puts on the bottom line of corporates, increased borrowing costs they buy, as well as the valuation effects it has, and shares will fall. So the interplay between inflation and interest rates is key, but it's not predictable. Instead, it's a good indicator of where sentiment is right now. And the fact that after the midterm elections, with a now hamstrung Congress, investors bought gives you an indication of where they're sitting on this issue. What they were saying was, well, growth prospects have slowed because we're not going to get more stimulus from the government, but that should mean the Fed slows down on its rate hiking. So lower interest rates, yay, let's buy stocks. It's an indication of the sentiment. This argument works both ways. So the responses are important. When the Fed came out on Thursday night and didn't change anything, people went, uh-oh, no, the Fed's not going to be deterred, and they started selling again. And many of you might know US markets sold off again last night. So we've seen a sentiment flip. One to watch out for, and a key issue. But the key factor for markets generally, for shares specifically, is growth. When economies are growing, generally speaking, companies are growing, earnings are growing, hopefully wages and prices are growing too. Earnings are growing. Analysts are revising earnings upwards. Share markets generally rise. So growth prospects are the key. And we've got three key regions we're watching at the moment: China and Asia broadly, Europe and the UK, and the United States and the Americas. Those three key regions drive the globe. They account for more than three quarters of the globe's growth. At the moment, there's no doubt about the US economy. It's in an upswing. In my view, there's very little doubt about the economy in China. It's very stable, and central authorities there will deliver what they've promised, as they've done for at least 10 years. But there are some important numbers to watch on growth. And these are the numbers I'm watching right now. I mentioned those lines in the sand for the Australian market. Inflation, because it drives central bank activity, is a key issue for me. And in the US, the Fed doesn't look at the CPI, They look at what's known as the PCE. Now, I'm not going to drill into the economics of that for you. I just need to know that's the one that the Fed responds to. PCE is currently sitting at 2%, and that's the target. So any moves in either direction from the PCE will determine what the Fed does, whether it speeds up or slows down its tightening timetable. That's the one I'm watching. In Australia, the RBA targets inflation between 2 and 3%. And so any break, at the moment we're sitting in that low twos level. So the RBA's on hold and will be until we see inflation make a sustained move in either direction. When it comes to that interplay between interest rates and inflation, the key for mine is that level on US 10-year bonds. If US 10-year bonds go above that price, that'll be a sign, because that's the 7-year high yield for the 10-year bond, that will be a sign that they're heading substantially higher and the market's about to get concerned about interest rates in a big way. So if you're looking for a chaotic event out of the interest rate markets for shares, that's the line in the sand in my book. A rise of the US 10-year bond above that level will put real pressure on US shares and the rest of the world. And in terms of growth, these are the numbers that I'm looking for. I believe growth, GDP growth, will stay between 6 and 7%. And in Europe, currently at 2.1%, that's the surprise factor. That's why markets doing a lot better than they possibly were expected to, because European growth has surprised. So that's the potential source of disruption to growth expectations.